Gallion, and welcome to Peaceworks. In this episode, we're going to hear from Tony Campolo. We asked some people the following question. Is Christianity a peace movement?
Yeah, I definitely think it is. I think the basis of it is, no matter what angle you look at it, it's about loving people. And if you're loving someone, you're not fighting with them and you're not hurting them. And that's just a peaceful movement.
God's creations are special if you're a Christian. And you just totally want to keep them like good, and you know that like you don't want to get get stones thrown at you, so why do it to others, because you're all equal.
In the most organic sense of the word, of like the most organic Christianity, yes. I think if you ask somebody on the street, is Christianity a peace movement, they would probably say no. But I do believe Christianity as in Jesus as our leader, we're Christians, we follow Jesus. Yes, that is a peace movement. I think there is a lot of repenting and relearning that Christians need to do, because I think we've fallen away from that. And maybe because of pride or ego, Christians have sort of tried to, defend themselves or something. And so, yeah, like the Crusades, that was a while ago, but I mean, that comes up all the time. Like, think about what Christians have done. Like, I don't want to be part of that. So I think there needs to be tons of repenting done by Christians now, to be just honest and say, we've screwed up in this area, but we definitely want to make it right, and constantly live out a peace movement. Yeah.
Christianity is definitely a peace movement. I think that Jesus is very peaceful and wanted peace and wanted everyone to deal with different situations in a peaceful, loving way. And so the more people decide to follow Jesus, the more peaceful this world can become.
Let's see what some other people had to say.
Thank you. think that Gandhi had said it right. He once declared that everybody knows what Jesus taught, except for Christians. There's truth to that. Anybody outside of the Christian faith, reading the red letters of the Bible, namely the words of Jesus that are highlighted in red, would have to come to the conclusion that to be Christian is to be committed to nonviolent resistance. Note, I said nonviolent resistance rather than pacifism. I think the word pacifism has lost its edge, primarily because it suggests that we stand back and do nothing when evil is expressing itself, when evil seems to be rampant in the land. That's not what Jesus calls us to do. He calls us to resist evil, but to do it in nonviolent ways. Turning the other cheek is a case in point. In the ancient world, it wasn't that you just turned the other cheek passively, but that you stared your opponent down. You looked at him right in the eye and almost said, "Is that the best you can do? I'm ready to take whatever you have to offer. I believe what I believe, and I will strongly stand and face you down, even as you perpetuate pain and suffering on me." The Jesus of Scripture does, in fact, call upon us to resist evil, but to resist evil in a nonviolent way. I think that this goes not only in terms of war, but the whole taking of life has to be taken seriously here. Jesus said, "Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy." And you say, what does that mean? In the United States, I have to say to the evangelical community, it means that you have to be opposed to capital punishment. I mean, if you don't show mercy, should you expect mercy from God? You say, well, what if somebody commits a murder? Shouldn't he or she have to pay with one's life? Jesus says, that's the old law, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. I give you a new commandment. I don't want to be nasty, but when he says it's a new commandment, I think he means it's a new commandment. And that new commandment is overcome evil with good. Love your enemies. Of course, loving your enemies has ramifications for militarism, doesn't it? When the Bible says, love your enemies, and it does say that. Jesus says that very explicitly. I love the bumper sticker that I think the Church of the Brethren has out that says, when Jesus said, love your enemies, he probably meant we shouldn't kill them. I think that's a kind of an upfront statement. I think you have to face that as a reality. There's a whole movement in the United States among young people, and I think it's spreading around the world now via the internet. It's called Red Letter Christians. You can go to a website, redletterchristians.org, and you'll find that there are all kinds of young people who are blogging on this, who are calling for a posture of nonviolent resistance. It's spreading. I think we have about 1 million different people putting hits on that website in the past year. So it's a growing mindset to take the words of Jesus seriously. Shane Claiborne, who is kind of an icon with youth these days, has put out a book called Jesus for President, in which he makes this strong claim for nonviolent resistance. He and I have a book coming out together entitled The Red Letter Revolution. And the headline is, what if we took the words of Jesus seriously? Which I think is what the peace movement within the Christian community is really all about. Are we going to take Jesus seriously? Or are we going to call upon some theologians to come in and water down the words of Jesus? They once asked the great theologian Karl Barth, can theologians be saved? And he said, yes, because God can do anything. And what he really meant by that is that theologians have worked overtime to take the obvious teachings of Jesus and reduce them to a middle-class morality that doesn't challenge anybody to live a radical lifestyle. The question has to be raised. How radical is Christianity? Is it simply being nice? Is it simply adhering to the value system of the dominant culture? Or is Christianity, as it says in Romans, nonconformity? Be not conformed to this world. Or as J.B. Phillips translates that 12th chapter of Romans, don't let the world around you squeeze you into its little box, but let the Holy Spirit motivate you from within. Many years ago, many, many years ago, when I was young, and I'm old now, I mean, I've reached that point where when I go to a wedding, the bride's grandmother looks better to me than the bride. That's how old I am. Let me just say, when I was young, they basically drafted me or tried to induct me into the Army. It was during the Korean War. Most young people don't even know there was a Korean War. But they tried to induct me. And in the interview that I had at the draft office, the question was asked, what problems did I have with being in the military? I wasn't acquainted with the Anabaptist movement, or else I would have joined the Mennonite Church or the Brethren in Christ Church or something like that and gotten off the hook and gone into alternative conservatives. But I had read a book. It was a book entitled In His Steps by Charles Sheldon. It was a hot book at that time, back in the early 1950s. And the book was built around one serious question. If Jesus was in your place, what would he do? It was out of that book that we came up with this line, WWJD, what would Jesus do? And I explained to the man that was interviewing me. I said, I just can't imagine Jesus running a bayonet into somebody and cutting out his guts. To which the interviewer said with a smile, you know you're carrying it to extremes. 99% of the people who are in the military never kill anybody like that. Could you fly an airplane and drop a bomb? I said, well, when I'm ready to release the bomb on the city or on the military base, I would have to ask a serious question. Jesus, if you were in my place, would you drop this bomb? The interviewer yelled back at me, that's the dumbest thing I ever heard. Everybody knows that Jesus would never drop a bomb. And he laughed at his own answer. That's an interesting answer. I told that same story in 1987 at the Great Urbana Missions Conference at the University of Illinois. The military in the United States is so convinced that evangelicals are all militarists and would be supportive of the armed services no matter what, that they ended up buying the videotapes from that conference and sending a set of those videotapes to every military base in the world, so in case a chaplain wasn't there on a Sunday, they could show a video and a sermon that was sound and orthodox and politically safe would be shown. Of course, I was not politically safe. And of course, I asked the question, when did Christianity cease being politically dangerous? When did Christianity cease being countercultural? Because at that point, I have to ask, isn't that when Christianity ceased being Christianity? They showed this video and this story that I just told at the Vandenberg Air Force Base out in California. 250 bomber pilots were in the audience when the question was raised, would Jesus drop a bomb? And my answer, and the answer of the interviewer, everybody knows that Jesus would never drop a bomb. The chaplain said, we turned off the movie projector, the video projector, and we had a discussion. And he wrote me a rather eloquent reason why he thought in certain circumstances Jesus would drop bombs. I mean, he made the case strong, and very brilliantly articulated that position of militarism. And in that respect, he condemned what I had said and what happened in that story. However, he put a PS to the letter. And he said, however, I would be less than honest if I did not tell you that at the end of our discussion, there wasn't a single bomber pilot in that audience that thought that Jesus would ever drop a bomb. Now that becomes rather scary to me. If being a Christian is more than just accepting certain doctrines to be true, and I think we have intellectualized Christianity and have become concerned about orthodoxy. Are you orthodox? Do you believe the right doctrines? Do you say yes to these theological truths? Do you subscribe to the teachings of the Apostles' Creed? All of which I do. I am orthodox. I believe the Bible. That's why I am committed to peace. That's why I'm committed to nonviolent resistance, because I do take the words of Jesus seriously. So, you know, that became the concern of most churches. Are we raising up a group of orthodox, Bible-believing Christians? And Jesus said, good thing to go to Jesus. Jesus did not say, if you subscribe to the doctrines of orthodoxy, you will have eternal life. Jesus says, herein you are my disciples, in that you do whatsoever I command you. If you love me, you will keep my commandments. The questions are not simply, do you believe in Jesus? Do you believe as I do that he died on the cross and in that crucifixion atoned for our sins and delivered us from the punishment that we just deserve? I think the question is, do you love Jesus? Do you love him enough to say, I'll do what you want me to do. I'll be what you want me to be. I'll go where you want me to go. Any church historian will tell you that the early church, from the birth of Christianity up until the late 300s, up until the early 400s AD, was committed to a non-militaristic posture. The early church fathers contended that if you were going to be a Christian, you had to renounce militarism. You could not be part of the military. We know when it changed. It changed with what historians call the Constantinian Compromise. Christianity had always been treated as an obscene religion that was persecuted by the Roman authorities, until Constantine decided that he needed a religion that would unify the empire, and he chose Christianity. More reasons than that. When he was going into a crucial battle that would determine whether or not he would become the ruling Caesar of the empire, he had this dream, and in this dream he saw the Roman standards not carrying the Roman eagle as they always had, but the Roman standards had crosses, and he heard this voice that said, in this sign conquer. So the next day he had all the eagles removed, he had crosses put up there, and they won the battle. And so, in fact, the cross became an instrument of militaristic victory under Constantine, who then made it the acceptable. I wouldn't say he demanded that everybody become Christians, more liberal than that. But he let it be known that this was a religion that he had embraced, and that all of a sudden Christianity had moved into a privileged position. In exchange for that, the church capitulated on militarism, i.e., if they were going to get the support of the emperor, the least they could do is support the emperor's policies, i.e. his militarism. We have a definitive point at which militarism replaced nonviolent resistance as the style that the church would embrace in terms of its people. And it's been that way ever since. There are all of those who argue for the just war theory. You know, there are certain conditions. I cannot understand when there is a just war. What constitutes a just war? Certainly the war in Iraq was not a just war by just war standards. The war in Afghanistan has not been a just war by standards there. Just war is impossible in today's society because just war requires that civilians, i.e. non-combatants, not be killed. In today's war, more than 90% of all the people that get killed are non-combatants. Take Afghanistan. Take Iraq. I mean, the United States has a right to weep over the fact that 4,000 young men and women lost their lives as military combatants. But take into consideration that there's an estimate that as many as 300,000 Iraqi citizens lost their lives. And what about Afghanistan, where drones are killing people? You say, yes, they've wiped out a cell here and a cell there of terrorists. Indeed, they have. But in the process, how many civilians have they killed? That's a prerequisite of a just war theory, according to John Calvin, according to the Reformed tradition, according to Augustine. So, you know, the just war theory is a very questionable one. The dropping of the atom bomb, which all will agree, brought World War II to a rapid end. So let me not minimize the other side's argument. Who knows how many people would have died had not the atomic bomb been dropped on Hiroshima. But we all know that ground zero, where the bomb was dropped, was a hospital in the middle of a civilian neighborhood. And almost all of the casualties of that bomb exploding were not military people, but were civilians. Now, please put that in the context of what St. Augustine, and later John Calvin and Martin Luther would call just war theory. I don't think you can, because the civilians are the primary casualties of these wars. When it's all said and done, I think that you have to go to Matthew 25, where Jesus says, "Whatever you do to the least of these, you do to me. All I ask of a soldier who's ready to kill another is to look into that soldier's eyes and ask a very simple question. Do I see Jesus staring back at me? And if I do, how can I kill him?" It's a good question. One last story to tell. A friend of mine was having dinner with a man who had been in the Battle of the Bulge, that famous battle during World War II. The lines of demarcation were blurred. Nobody knew where the front was. The soldiers were of the Nazi army and the soldiers of the Allied armies were intermixed with each other. They could not take prisoners. There was no means for sustaining prisoners, defeating prisoners. Things were desperate. And so both the Nazis and the Allies, and we never like to face this, would send out units each morning to see who was lying around, who was wounded, and kill them. This particular man was in such a unit. And he talked about going out one day and coming upon a Nazi soldier who was seated with his back against a tree. He wasn't wounded. He was just so dissipated with exhaustion he couldn't move. The American soldier came up, raised his gun, and before he could shoot, the Nazi soldier said, "Would you give me just a moment to pray?" He said it in perfect English. The American sat down with him and talked to him and said, "Are you a Christian?" And the Nazi soldier said, "Yes," and explained that he thought that his cause was ordained of God, as all armies believe their causes are ordained of God. When they moved beyond that, they began to talk about their families, about the children that they had back home. Each of them pulled out photographs of their children and showed them to each other. They shared a few verses of scriptures and prayed with each other. My friend said, "I kept on asking, man, well, what did you do? What did you do after that?" And the American soldier said, "I stood up. I raised my gun and I said, 'You're a Christian. I'm a Christian. I'll see you in heaven.' And I killed him." How do you do that? How do you do that? That's militarism at its worst, isn't it? That's militarism that says, I do not take the sacredness of the other person into consideration. And I do what I'm ordered to do, regardless of how many moral principles in my heart, mind, and soul are violated. I think we have to take Jesus seriously. Let me get back to that. Can you imagine Jesus being a soldier? Or would he rather let them crucify him?
If you have a father.